we're actually going to have one session during Sunday school and then a second session during the morning worship service. So we're going to kind of bookend the October Sundays with a couple special speakers. So those are going to be great times. So we are in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, 25 through 37. And I've titled this The Samaritan Neighbor, subtitled it A Story Within the Story. A Story Within the Story. And if we do just a bit of review as we go into this passage of Scripture, the 70 or 72 return with joy. They return with joy. Why? Because they were out proclaiming. I think you could still reduce this or pull it out of the monitors or something that's happening there. Just go up the channel and take it out of the monitors. And there we go. That's a little better. I just hear myself so much. I'm like, ah! That's okay. So they were 70 to 72 and they returned with joy. Why did they return with joy? They returned with joy because they have went out proclaiming. They went out to these towns, two by two, to these different towns that Jesus is going to go to before he gets to Jerusalem. And they are out proclaiming that Jesus is the Christ. The kingdom of God is near. And what does that make Jesus do? We find Jesus rejoicing. We find him rejoicing over the fact that, they have went out and did exactly what he told them to do. And they come back calling him the Lord. And so he is there rejoicing about what has happened. And he ends that time with looking at his disciples and pulling them aside and looking at them and saying, I got something special to tell you, that you're seeing things and hearing things that the prophets wish they would have seen or wish they would have heard that's there. And so it's a special time. And we ended it realizing it's also a special time for us because we are seeing and hearing God's plan fulfilled that Jesus was rejoicing about. We're in that time. We're in the time when Jesus has come. Jesus lived. He died. He was buried. He rose on the third day. He ascended into heaven. And he told us he's coming back again. And we're in that special time that we get to talk to others about the risen Lord, the risen Jesus Christ that's there. Special time. So in the midst of that, in the midst of all that was going on, here somebody breaks into the scene. Verse 25. Then an expert in the law stood up to test him, saying, Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? A lot of things in this passage right here. Someone goes beyond just raising their hand. Teacher. No, this person was sitting down, gets up, and therefore now he's the center of attention. And this person addresses Jesus not as Lord, but as teacher. You've got a lot of knowledge. You're able to communicate it to others. You're pretty good at that. But then we're given the man's motive. Why is he doing this? He's going to test to see how much the teacher actually knows. Because he's an expert in the law. He's the one that's got it all down. So he wants to lob something at this teacher and see if he knows what he's talking about. And it's hard because if we look at this, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And that crushed him with a question. And he does this a lot. He does it a lot. If you read the scriptures, you'll see this is common for Jesus to do this. He asks a question. Someone asks him a question. He asks them a question, kind of thing. And the expert plan backfires. Because it should have been, Jesus should have just answered the question, right? And now he didn't. He asked another question. So he's like, now what am I going to do? It's interesting that Jesus directs him back to what he already has. The question that Jesus answers with, through the question, is something that drives him back to where the answer is. He drives him back, what does the law say? The law is something he already has. He's an expert in the law. He knows the law. So it takes him right back to what he already has. A lot of the answers that we need in life are what? We already have. It's already in your hands or your tablet or whatever you use. It's already there. He drives him back to that. And I just tried to rephrase the question here. If you were able to obtain eternal life by your actions, what would you need to do? If you were able to obtain eternal life by your actions alone, what would you need to do? Now, that's not a biblically right, but I'm just trying to phrase the question that's there. So he's driving them back, the expert in the law, back to the law, to say, what would that answer be? 29, but wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" I want you to notice a few things right there. He doesn't talk about God. He jumps right over God and goes right to the neighbor part of the statement. He's almost like, yeah, I love God perfectly. And he jumps right over to his neighbor. And he wants to find the limits of that love. He didn't seek to humble himself, but rather to justify himself. Instead of hearing what the law said about how we're to love God and love others, and instead of him humbling himself and saying, "Lord, how do you do that?" He stands up even more on his tiptoes in order to justify himself. Instead of admitting and repenting and calling out for mercy, he seeks his own righteousness. He says, "Yeah, but what about my neighbor?" There has to be a loophole. Nobody can do this. And therefore, what is the limit of this love? What's the limit? Because I know as I read that, this is like no way. How can we fulfill all that? So then Jesus goes on, and this is great, because Jesus took up the question. He took up the man's question, this question, "And who is my neighbor?" And said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him, beat him up, and fled, leaving him half dead." Jesus answers the question with a story. He just, as you read through, he does this often too. Maybe Jesus pointed to the man when he started the story. A certain man was going down the road. Maybe he pointed to that. I don't know. Jerusalem's 3,000 feet above sea level, and Jericho is 1,000 feet below sea level. That's 4,000 feet there. And it's only 17 miles between them. So that's quite a steep grade or descent, whichever way that you're going. The road that he's talking about is a great place for crime, and known for crime. And a lot of different crevices and places where criminals could hide out and ambush someone who is going either way that's there. And we see that it's more than just a robbery. They didn't just come up and say, "Give us your wallet." No. They took his clothes. They beat him up. He's half dead on the road. They stripped him. I mean, Jesus is a good storyteller, and he paints the picture so in your mind you can see the guy on the road, on the side of the road, bleeding, and you're not sure if he's dead or alive, okay? So Jesus goes on to say, a priest happened to be going down that road. When he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Now just kind of imagine yourself as the person on the road, and you're beat up, and you're not sure if you're going to live, but you can look out one eye, you look out one eye, and you see somebody coming, and here comes a priest who would have been church leadership, and you would have known it was a priest because of the special clothing that they wore and everything else. You go, "Oh, that's a priest." And you would have maybe a little hope. Who better to come my way than a priest? Man, this is the best person to come along my way. Those who know the law will definitely follow the law, right? Well, we know differently in this one. But maybe some of these verses went through his head. Leviticus 19:34 says, "You will regard the alien who resides with you as a native born among you. You are to love him as yourself. For you were aliens in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God." So he's like, man, I'm not an alien. I'm one of them. So surely if they have to love the alien, they'll love me. Or maybe this one, Exodus 23:4-5. "If you come across your enemy's stray ox or donkey, you must return it to him. If you see the donkey of someone who hates you lying helpless under its load, and you want to refrain from helping it, you must help with it." So you're laying there going, well, I'm worth more than an ox and a donkey. So surely he'll stop and help me. Or maybe Psalm 37:21, "A wicked person borrows and does not repay, but the righteous one, like a priest, a religious leader, is gracious and giving." So as he's looking out one eye, maybe, looking and seeing the robes of this priest, thinking, oh, all right, my salvation has come. Or Micah 6:8, "Mankind, he has told each of you what is good and what is the Lord requires of you, to act justly, to love faithfulness, and to walk humbly. the assistant to the priest. They assisted the priest. And here's the leadership principle. We follow the actions of our leaders. So what did they do? They did exactly what their leaders were doing. So if their leaders would ignore a situation like this, they just ignored the situation also. And your assumption about where your salvation is coming from is wrong. As you're laying there looking and thinking that this religious organization is going to save me, is going to somehow rescue me, you're wrong. It's not coming from them. Jesus has got to introduce someone else in the story. And if we just want to throw Jesus in here, did Jesus get any help from the priests and the religious? No, that didn't happen. So, let's redefine Good Samaritan to Jesus' level of that term. And I think this is really important that we do this, because we have reduced that term down so much. Somebody does something, we say, oh, that was a Good Samaritan. And it's not even close. I mean, we call it now pay it forward. And we pay it forward while we're in the drive-thru at Starbucks, for the guy behind us in the Maserati who's pulling up for a $7 latte. And we go, oh, I feel so good. Man, I'm paying it forward. That's a Good Samaritan. I was a Good Samaritan today. But yeah, exactly. Okay, let's look at Jesus. That's Mark. Sorry, I got carried away that. But a Samaritan on his journey came up to him, and when he saw the man, he had compassion. You see, this is someone else that Jesus is introducing into the story. So, someone you would assume not to help. So you're laying there on the road, and you got one eye open, and you look, and you go, oh, wait a minute, that's a foreigner. Well, that's a Samaritan. Oh, he's not even the right color. Well, maybe he'll trip over me. I don't know. Someone away from home. Someone who's foreign to you. And here's the first step in GS. GS is Good Samaritan. Because I want to redefine what Jesus says, what it means to be a Good Samaritan. First thing is noticing. He notices. A Good Samaritan notices. All those in Sunday school class over the summer, and that's number one, right? Good step. First step is noticing. Second step is compassion. Second step is compassion. Something happens within you that you realize that you need to do something, and compassion is fearing in action. So that welling up within you is going to drive you to he said, you know, here, innkeeper, he pulled the innkeeper into the fray and said, okay, I've got a job for you. I want you to help out this guy. So he pulls in support staff for him. Ninth step of a Good Samaritan's follow-up. He says, I'm coming back. I'll come back. I'm going to check on him. And if there's anything that was, I'm going to make do on him. I'm coming back. See, wow, that is quite a definition of what it means to be a Good Samaritan from the lips of Jesus. And a denarii is a day's wage. And so two denarii would have been about 2 months worth of lodging. So you realize how bad this guy is off if he needs that much. And this type of love is definitely over the top. Definitely over the top. And many times when we read the story of the Good Samaritan, many times if we're really honest about it, we're the Levite and the priest. We see something that's ever before us, and you know what? We're like, how can I get around that? How can I get around that? I can't deal with that right now. And you walk by on the other side of the road. Usually that's what we do. Every once in a while, you'll hear of a Good Samaritan in light of what Jesus says. It many times makes the news kind of thing. Because it is so over the top. And we realize that many times we're not a Good Samaritan in light of what Jesus says a Good Samaritan is. Not saying that we can't be. But many times we're not. Now, just a little break here, because a story within a story. Here's the story within a story. You're the one lying dead on the road. And who comes down your road? And who sees you? And who has compassion on you? And who picks you up and heals your wounds? And who pays the expense, and who paid it all for you? And who puts you in a support staff of his own family to help you to grow and heal? And who said he was coming back to you? Who did that for you? Jesus is describing himself. He's the Good Samaritan. He's the one who can love God like that and love others every single time. Now, who loves like this all the time? Jesus. Jesus asked him a question now, a very direct question. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? And the lawyer's on the spot now. Is it the priest? Is it the Levite? Or is it the Samaritan? Which one is it? It's on the spot. Remember, he's standing up in front of him. Well, Jesus said, who proved to be? Proved to be means the person acted upon it rather than just say it. And I'm sure that many times the expert in the law had a lot to say. But there was a lot that he didn't do. And he said, a Good Samaritan is one who does. Doesn't just know it, but proves it through his very actions. What did Jesus do on the cross? He proved it. What did he do by raising from the grave? He proved it. What did he do by ascending to be at the right hand of the Father? He proved it to us. Who's the one who proves it? Jesus. And this is a more direct question that's given to him. And so he responds, the one who showed mercy to him. He said, then Jesus told him, go and do the same. Now, the lawyer defines this type of love as mercy. That's interesting. He describes this kind of outlandish love that is beyond anything that they could even imagine. He called that mercy. And the answer of Jesus is the same after the requirement of the law and the story from himself. See, when they ask him about the law, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. He says, go and you will live. He said, yeah, that's the answer. Go do it. When he gets done with the story about the Good Samaritan, yeah, we should be more neighborly. Yeah, we should stop more often. Yeah, we should help out a little bit more. That's what they'll hear. That's a good message to hear. That's a good thing to hear. But I'm praying this morning that some will see salvation. Some will see salvation in this story. Who gives mercy? Jesus gives mercy. Maybe you hear salvation that you would be someone who would rather stand, instead of standing up to justify yourself, you would be down on your knees repenting and being in submission to God. Because he's the one who stops. He's the one who picks us up. And he's the one who pays the bill. He's the one who provides for support. And he's the one who's come again. And so that makes me reference back to verse 21. And Jesus rejoicing that we read last week. Verse 21 says this. At that time, he, Jesus, rejoiced in the Holy Spirit and said, I praise you, Father. I want you to notice right there, there's the Trinity. Jesus is rejoicing in the Holy Spirit, and he's speaking to the Father. So we've got the Trinity going there. I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent. You have hidden these things from the expert in the law who stood up and all he can think about is justifying himself. You've hidden it from them, and you revealed them to the infants. You've revealed them to the ones who realize that they need the one that's coming down the road that's foreign to them right now, but that's where their salvation is coming from. You've revealed it to the infants. And then he goes on to say, yes, Father, because this was your good pleasure. So I pray this morning, as we've heard that story many times, many Sunday school classes and things like that, where we went through that. There's probably plenty of you who could tell me that story pretty verbatim, you know, back. I pray this morning that you will hear more than just, we need to be better neighbors. I hope that you hear salvation, that someone is coming down your road. And someone wants to tend to you and pick you up. And he'll use all of his resources on you. He'll pay the price of your sin on the cross. He'll put you in a church family, his support group. And he'll give you the promise that he's coming back to you. I hope you hear salvation. Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for our opportunity to be in your house and for this beautiful passage of Scripture. Lord, I pray, Lord Jesus, that we would just be ever so thankful for you and how you stop for us. And if there's anyone here today to realize that's you on the road. That their salvation is not going to come from any religious organization. It's not going to come from anything that this world offers. Their salvation is only going to come from this one that's coming down the road. He's a foreigner to you at this time. But he wants to be your friend. He wants to be your savior. And that he paid the price on the cross for his sins. So I pray, if there's anyone here this morning, they would recognize you coming down the road. They would recognize, Lord, all the provisions that you give to those who humbly come before you. And we ask this precious name. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with us as we sing the final song?
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin,